Welcome to the Rhema Family Church Youth Service. Let's go. Let's go. First of all, I want to give God all the glory and honor for allowing us to do this. And second of all, thank you, pastors, for allowing us to do this as well. So, this evening, you're going to see some awesome gifts from our youth, from God's youth. And what you will expect tonight is some more word. Come on, yeah. And then some praise, and then some worship. Yes, yeah, yes. So, just going to open up in prayer. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for this opportunity, Lord. And we just pray, Lord, that that you'll speak through the gifts. What are you doing? What are you doing tonight?
Study.
Come again?
Study.
I can't hear you.
Study.
One more time.
Study.
Yeah! Who's next? You're up, Lydia. Go.
So, some of you will know I've been off in uni, and I haven't even been back a week, and they got me up here doing notices. Now it's all good. So first up, we have prayer meetings. Yeah! Must say, I haven't been to any yet, but Tuesday, 6:30 a.m., I'm going to fix my sleep schedule and I'm going to be there. Yeah! So I'm going to remember who's not there. No. But come along. As far as I remember, they're pretty powerful, so we'll see. We're on day 14 of fasting and praying. Yeah. Pastor Barry's enthusiastic. Once again, haven't quite jumped on that train yet, but I'm going to jump on it this week. And worship service Wednesday, 7 p.m. Sounds popular. Do we have any visitors? Welcome! See all that applause? Just for you. Just for you! Foil? Voyo. She's Auntie's friend. Yeah! And we also have our garden. Could we get Chris up to say a little something about the garden?
Thank you very much. If someone had asked me what my profession was, I would have had another answer, but Lydia's apparently told me what my profession is. From Tuesday onwards, apparently. Are you the garden man? So, yeah. Yep, I'm the garden man. Do you know the garden man, the garden man? On a more serious note, I must apologize. I thought I was so clever because I managed to do a little special group, but I think I was perhaps a little paranoid on membership. And I don't know what I did, but only one person in the entire congregation was able to join. So I'm not saying anything. The name was King. I thought it was King's Seeds, but it's not. So anyway, so sorry. I am going to get some adult help and fix this. True. Yeah, I need teenage help, actually. So if there are any millennials out there who want to have a laugh. So Thank you so much for all of the amazing response so far. As you can see, we're still finding our way here. But on this coming Saturday, shall we say about 10 a.m.? This is on the fly. 10 a.m., we're looking to do a working bee here. So we'll be able to start getting things going. We'll hopefully have some material that we can place on. We've got the seeds. We've got heaps and heaps of seeds. And then we can make some space to put in the trees, which we've got. I've got to pick up. We've got a 15 citrus trees, which we've received. So it's, no, this is going to be big.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. So thank you, everyone, for your support. All guidance, most welcome, and I think we're going to grow a lot.
Yep. And please put your name down at the office. So give Ronnie a call, say, yeah, I'm available and I've got whatever tools or I can just help with labour. So just let us know that you're coming so we can kind of gauge how much help we have and what we can accomplish. Awesome.
Thank you.
Oh, other way, sorry.
Thank you. So, anything we're missing? No. Okay, good. So that's what we got coming up this week. Sounds like a blast of a week. I'm going to have to fix my sleep schedule to make it to prayer meeting. Maybe we shall pray for strength for that. But I'll hand it off to Josh now. Funny stuff. Here we go to Uncle.
It's not really funny, but can we get some people coming to the middle, if that's possible? Just if possible. But if you're comfortable where you are, cool, all good. Do you want me to tell a dad joke? What? I'm confused. Yes, no. What did the dog say to the detective? Should be obvious. The dog say to the detective, "I got a lead." Hand you over to Josh.
Sorry, guys. The allusion to Sparta sort of hurt my throat a bit. But how are we tonight? That's good. Now, you may be thinking, what is this kid doing up here? What could he possibly have to say? And I'll tell you the truth, I am just a kid. I'm not the pastor, and I'm definitely not an elder. And to be honest, I barely know why I'm up here myself. But I come to you bearing the most important message of your life, whether you've heard it before or not. I come to you bringing the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah. And his perfect sacrifice on the sin for our, on the cross for our sins. I remember listening to Paul Washer once, and he said this one thing which really hit me hard and stuck with me. He was talking about how he was a guest speaker once in front of a large group of people. The host told him that most of the people there were Christian and asked him what he was going to preach on. And then he said, well, I was thinking of preaching on the gospel. And these people were confused, as they had just told him that most of the people there were Christian. And Paul replied with, well, I appreciate that, but I can never assume that everyone in here is truly Christian. And secondly, the gospel isn't just for the lost. Wow. Now, this stuck with me because I realized that indeed there are people who may not know Jesus. I remember Pastor Don McDonnell said that he was preaching as a guest before as well, and he called people up to the altar. There was someone who'd been going to church for 2 months, and they didn't know Jesus. He also told another story about he was up preaching again, and he waited at the altar because he knew there was someone in there who needed to know Jesus. He waited there for a while, but no one came up until eventually someone did. That night they got saved, but unfortunately they also passed away. Now to the next part. Who is Jesus? Jesus was God's son and was sent to earth as a man facing the same struggles as we all do, the same temptations. Jesus grew up the same way as any other person, and according to the Gospel of Luke, wasn't particularly special until he was around 30, where he went and got baptized by his cousin John the Baptist. Then he was immediately sent by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness, where he fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. Sounds familiar? To be tempted by the devil, but he did not falter. Mark 1:12. After he had come out of the wilderness, he began his ministry, where he ran around preaching to anyone who would listen and healing the sick everywhere he went. As the time grew by, he had grown a very large following, and this worried the Romans, so they began to plot his death. Then, according to Matthew 26, on Passover day, Judas, one of Jesus' disciples, betrayed Jesus for 30 silver pieces. He told the Romans where Jesus would be that night so that they could arrest him. And John 19 says that that very night the Romans came and arrested him and took him to Pilate to be judged. However, Pilate said he found no fault in Jesus, but the crowd rebelled, so Pilate agreed to have him beaten and whipped. After this, the crowd still wasn't satisfied, so he finally gave in and let them crucify Jesus. And those silver pieces, well, according to Google, don't know how trustworthy it is, but they're only worth $270 now. The life of the Son of God, only for $270. But this was actually all part of God's plan. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and have come short of the glory of God." And Romans 6, verses 23, hang on. Says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." Now, this may sound like a bunch of rubbish, but I can explain it to you. To sin is to disobey any of God's commandments, and everyone has done this. Have you ever lied, stolen, or dishonored your parents? Have you ever hated or lusted over someone? And the answer is yes. But God had pity on us and gave us a way to be freed. Before now, in order for people to be saved, they had to sacrifice animals to God. But Jesus came, did not sin once, and was killed, becoming the perfect sacrifice, so that everyone may be forgiven. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Amen. He that believes in him is not condemned, but he that believes not is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So he may have come into the world for our sins and died for us, but only if you acknowledge it. Romans 10 verses 9. That if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. But why should you? Because I don't want you to go to hell. I don't want you to suffer endlessly. But don't be mistaken. This isn't just some easy escape. If you did give your heart to the Lord, then you aren't safe from there on out. After you've given your heart to the Lord, the devil will attack you more than ever. And your job is to stay strong from there on out. But don't be afraid, because God will be with you. Now, we would like to invite you up to the altar if you haven't accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, so that we as the youth can pray with you. Or even if you would just like to recommit your life to him.
We're taking this back to basics, way back to basics, because sometimes we forget, right? So I'm just going to safely assume we all know Christ as our Savior. But even us as established Christians forget that we actually need to download him so that we can fill up, so we can give out, because that's our Great Commission, right? So let me ask you this. Do you want more of God or more from God? So the two are kind of somewhat interlinked in one way, and in other ways, not at all. If you want more from God, doesn't mean you get more of God. It's just another way of using him to get what you want. But wanting more of God is desiring him for what he is in himself. Wanting more of him is partaking in his divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. That comes from 2 Peter 1:4. If we go back a couple of verses, this is what it says. His divine power has given to us all things which pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers in divine nature. So taking a little bit from our pastor, who likes to teach us about Greek words, which... Have you ever tried to pronounce a Greek word? Man, it's pretty much like speaking in tongues. But partake in the Greek is the word koinonos, which pretty much means to be a sharer in, or an associate, a companion, and a partner. Isn't that what we want to be? Right? So, if you want more of God, and we are partakers and partners in and with him, then by default, we get more from God, right? We get more blessings, more abundance, so much more, so that all we know is that it is him, it's from him, even if we don't know why. You asked the question, Pastor? How? Let me tell you how. Let me tell you how. I heard that. So I've asked myself the same question. You know, you kind of go to conferences and you watch people preaching on TV, or you just watch people around you and you're like, I want what they've got. How do I get what he's got? How do I stand up and talk to somebody I don't know about Jesus? You know, Pastor Naomi's been preaching a while ago, and the disciples walked past people and their shadows touched them and they were healed. I want that. Don't you? But how can we get that? It's pretty simple. You can keep watching the battery in the back. It's just downloading, uploading, giving out. So, like most things, okay, I only know one other thing. Not that it was for personal use, just saying. The AA, not the mechanics. They say there's like 12 steps to get to where you want to be and what you want. With the AA, it's getting sober. But I've got not quite 12. I condensed that quite a bit. There's just a few steps, basic ones, how we can download more of God so that we can fill up, so we can give out. All right? Easiest one. Okay, well, maybe not for Lydia, but pretty simple. Get quiet. Find that secret place for you and for God. Your bedroom, the bathroom, your car, doesn't matter where it is. Just the place where it can be you and him. No phones, no TVs, no kids. Yep, nobody, just you and him, so that you can talk to him. In Matthew 6:6, it says, when you pray, go into your room, shut the door, pray to God your Father, who is in that secret place, and he will hear you. Amen. 9 times out of 10, you hear him back. You just have to get quiet and listen. Another one, read your Bible. We all do that, right? We do that. Underline, highlight, write the scriptures that speak to your heart and declare them. Decree them over your life. It says to us in Proverbs 18:21, and most of us know what that is. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. And those who love it will eat its fruit. Also, I'm starting to like Matthew quite a bit. In Matthew 12:34-35, it says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. A good man, out of good treasure of his heart, brings forth good things. An evil man, out of the evil treasures, bring forth evil things. So fill your heart with good things. You want it to be good. Amen. Get a journal. Write out your prayers. Date it. And when it comes to pass, kind of take it off and say, yes, I see it. Amen. Pastor Barry spoke about that when he was doing the Kingdom series. That's the one, Kingdom Dynamics. Get that journal and do it. It's amazing what you can see. You get prophecies, write it in that same book. Go back, read through it, and see just how much you've grown in God because of him. Go for a walk in nature. Talk to Dad while marveling at his works. Sometimes, though, you know, with this wonderful world around us, you know, those stupid viruses, mosquitoes, global warming, all that stuff. It's a little bit tough to look and think, oh my gosh, look at this place. God made it for me. But if you do look just a little bit closer, you can see that God takes care of every single detail. Another Matthew scripture. I told you I'm liking Matthew. 6:26, the Bible tells us how God provides for birds. Birds, I mean, come on. What do? They look pretty, they tweet a lot, they poop in our cars. But he even worries about where they're going to sleep and what they're going to eat. They don't wake up thinking, oh my gosh, I don't have a job. How am I going to get that worm? It's just there. If you live at my mom's house, there's a big window at their kitchen, and there's like rice and seeds and bread and all that stuff that just gets chucked out for them. They've even learned if they sit on the ledge and they look into the window, the food will come. It does. Another good one is go out and share Jesus with the world. Share him with your best friend. Share him with your family. Tough one to do sometimes. But you know, share him and then bless them without expecting anything back. Another Matthew scripture. I like Matthew, you know. So Matthew 28, 16 to 20. Who knows this one? Come on. I think Pastor Barry Ritchie's Bible. So yes, this is the Great Commission. And what it says is, go and make disciples of all nations. Your friends, your family, the person standing in that line behind you in that long queue at Pack and Save, they got nothing better to do. Talk to them. And when you do, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them all that is commanded. And when you say, I can't do that. I'm not a pastor. I'm not a preacher. That Jesus goes on to say that he is with you always, till the ends of the age. So it doesn't matter why you feel you can't do it. Just say, hey, you're with me. You said I can do this. Do it. And one of the last things, and I'm sure there's heaps more, but it's what we're doing as a church and a family already. Fast. It helps us focus. It helps us to hear God's voice. But with fasting, pray. Read your word. Download more of him. The more we can incorporate fasting and prayer into our lives, the more we'll be attuned to what he wants us to do for him. Lots of Bible references from the Old Testament, although I mainly use Matthew, just saying. But throughout the Bible, you know, I think it's kind of important why we need to download him. We need to download him more so that our spirit man can get filled up, so we can give it out and keep going. And the last reason to recharge ourselves is, you know, when those horrible mosquitoes come and season is coming. No, don't kill them. They're going to suck your blood like they do. But we'll be so filled up with him. They'll suck and they'll fly away singing, there's wonder-working power in that blood. I've been with Pete a long time. Next part.
Thank you, Father, let you speak through me. Not my thoughts, but your thoughts, Father. More of you, less of me, Lord. Have peace. All right, are you enjoying the service so far? It's awesome, eh? Right. 1 second. Right, so I'm going to ask a question. Would like some crowd participation, please. Right, so what do believers and extension cords have in common? I was going to say, what do humans and extension cords have in common? But we are humans, and once we accept Jesus into our heart, you know, and confess our sins, then we become believers. So, yeah. So, what do believers and extension cords have in common? So, can I?
Ability to carry power.
Okay. Yep.
Power.
Yes. Anyone else? Connection. Yes. You are all right. You bang on. Bang on. Yes.
Can be turned on and off.
Very good. Very good. Very good. Very, very good. Awesome. You are all absolutely correct. I'm going to look at this at a bit of a different angle, which Pastor Naomi has already said the answer to. It's all right. It's all right, though. Yeah. It's cool. So think about the extension cord. If the extension cord is not plugged into a power source, there will be no power, because the extension cord by itself has no power. But it has the ability to carry the power. Right. Thank you. So I'm going to plug this thing in. Excuse me one moment. Works tonight. Boom. Yeah. So, but when it's plugged into the power source, the exact same power that the power source has is available at the end of the extension cord, as long as it stays connected, right? So, as believers, we were created with the ability to carry the power of God through the Holy Spirit if we stay connected to Him. So, let's first of all have a quick look at the ability. The ability first. So, I'm going to go to, you don't have to follow this, but I'm just going to go to John 15:5, which says, "I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing." And the second one I'm going to back that up with is the Amplified version of 2 Timothy 1:7. "For God did not give us a spirit of timidity or cowardice or fear, but He has given us a spirit of power, of love, of sound mind and judgment, of personal discipline," in brackets, "abilities that result in a calm and well-balanced mind and self-control." That is, well, yeah, awesome. So now we're going to look at the power of the Holy Spirit through God, carrying the power. So I'm going to go to Ephesians 3:14-20. If you want to follow, open up the Bibles and follow me, you can. If you got it, say got it. All right. So, Ephesians 3:14-20. But warm. Got it. Ooh. Got it? Cool. All right. Everyone ready for the next part? All right. So, in this, Paul is talking to the Ephesians. He's actually praying to them, or praying for them, saying, "For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from this whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of His glorious riches He may strengthen you with the power through His Holy Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted," so rooted is like, if you think of a tree planted right into the ground, so it's it's more than connected, as Sherry was saying. It's is right down. You've got to be really in him. Yeah. And rooted and established in love. May have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide, how long, how high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who was able to do immeasurably more than we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. So here we see that he talks about how God will strengthen us through the power of the Holy Spirit. He talks about how being more than connected, but being rooted and established in him, we will have power in him. And so he also says that God can do immeasurable things more than we ask or imagine, according to the power that is at work within us. Connected to him, he's at work within us, and he comes out of us. So I would like to go to Acts, drop another scripture in here. Sorry, chapter 1, verse 7. Got it? Oh, what? Didn't I highlight? Oh, yes, thank you, Lord. All right, so it says, and he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or seasons for which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So to end this off, all of you are extension cords. Your extension cords of God's power, his love, his grace, his mercy, his peace, his kindness, and his truth. But if you're not plugged in, no one's going to get anything at the other end. So stay plugged in. God bless you. Thank you. Cool. And now we have tithes and offerings.
Good evening, family. How are we tonight?
Great.
How are you? We are fabulous.
So for us, when it comes to getting paid from our jobs, it's like a reward from God. In the Bible, this is how we see it.
Mark 12:41-44. If you want to turn there, you can. So you got it when you got it. In God's economy, it's not the amount of money we give, but the attitude of our heart when we give it. The widow who gave 2 small copper coins is the perfect example for this. While rich people were tossing large amounts of money into the temple treasury, the poor widow only gave an offering that was worth a few pennies. Yet Jesus praised her for it. God doesn't need our money. He owns all the cattle on 1,000 hills. He does, however, want us to use our money wisely in such a way that includes offering back to him, a proportion of it to be used in building the kingdom of God. As Paul explains in the believers in the church of Corinth, each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver.
Thank you, God, for this night service and tithes and offerings and those who are offering and tithing. Bless everyone here tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.
Ashes.
Tisha attended Carmel Intermediate School, where she was constantly surrounded by temptations and influences. She had a very good group of friends. They were all Christian and attended the same church together. They were always very kind and encouraging to one another. They often spoke of the love of God and what he had done in their lives, and were always such good influences on each other. But Tish couldn't help but notice the loud, rowdy, cool kids. It always looked like they were having so much fun, pranking each other, making foul jokes, getting up to all sorts of mischief and doing whatever they wanted. Tish couldn't help but feel like she was missing out on the fun. One day, curiosity got the better of her, so she told her friends that she was going to hang out with those other kids because they were cooler and looked like they were having more fun. Her friends were very worried about her, as they knew the types of things these other kids would get up to. But they let her go anyway, and off she went to join the cool kids. Tish was having loads of fun at first and started doing things she usually would never do. They would bunk class to get up to all sorts of mischief. They would clown around and pull nasty pranks on people, tease, hurt, and bully each other for laughs, and even bully others for fun too. One day, Tish was pulled aside from the rest of the crowd and told to bully the new kid who had accidentally tripped her over in cross country earlier. She was told to get him back and make him pay for what he did to her. And if she didn't make him pay, then she's a wimp. Tish didn't want these cool kids thinking she was a wimp. So she walked over to this kid, ready to hit him. And just as she raised her hand,
so I'm sure by now you can kind of gather what's going on. Oh, thank you. So cool. So just in case you are taking notes, this is called the value of good friendships. Who here has friends, like real friends? Acquaintances, almost friends, the bros, the mates, you know, besties, people you spend time with. Are friendships and relationships important? Why? Okay, I hear you. Did you know, though, there are many different types of good friendships mentioned in the Bible? It says that a good friendship is like a fine wine. Wait, oh, sorry. Wrong crowd. What it actually says is slightly different. Doesn't get better with age, although it should, but not like a fine wine. In Proverbs 7:17, it says, a friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. The Message translation kind of says, friends love through all kinds of weather, and families stick together in all kinds of trouble. Amen. Another great scripture about friendship is Ecclesiastes 4:9-12. I'm only looking at him because this was our marriage scripture. And the other night when I mentioned it, he was like, well. Yeah. But yeah. So what it says, and I'm sure we all do know it, kind of, two are better than one, because they have good reward for their labor. For if one falls, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who has nobody when he falls. Again, if two lay down together, and this is not for you guys, wait for marriage. They will keep each other warm. But how can one be warm alone? Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him. Most importantly, a threefold cord is not easily broken. Amen. Amen. A scripture just to keep in mind for a little bit later, or maybe even just before, comes from Proverbs again. In 22, 24, and 25, it says, make no friendship with an angry man, and with a furious man do not go, lest you learn his ways and set a snare for your soul. So important, it's even reiterated again in the New Testament. In 1 Corinthians 15:33, do not be misled. Bad company corrupts good character. Can anybody think of some of these friendships in the Bible, the good friendships? Yeah? Yep. Who else? Mm-hmm. I'll give you the three that I came up. David and Jonathan, definitely. Joshua and Caleb. So, Scripture tells us that after David defeated Goliath, David was brought before King Saul. In 1 Samuel 18, the Bible says that Jonathan became one in spirit with David, and that he loved him as he loved himself. Saul even kept David away from his family and moved him into the palace. The Bible goes on to say that Jonathan made a covenant with David and even gave him his tunic, the clothes that he wore on his back, and his sword. Coming from somebody who is fit to be the next king, that is a huge gesture. These two didn't even need time to build up their friendship. You know, sometimes you meet somebody and you just click. You know that you know that you know you are going to be such good friends. You don't have to see each other every day. You don't have to talk on the phone. You can see them months later. And the minute you lay eyes on each other, it's like there was no time missed in between. You just know it's there. This is the type of friendship that these two had. A good friend recognizes strengths and abilities in each other, even if it means that the other one is going to get promotion and you don't. There was also Elijah and Elisha. Also a little bit of a strange friendship. One was an older, wiser counselor, and the other one was a young guy who wanted to learn his ways. And he did. Another example is Ruth and Naomi. Friendships that are born from tragedy. You never would have expected it. Naomi didn't want this. Ruth persisted, and a friendship was born. But what I want to focus on just a little bit more are four friends. Five if you include the other, but let's focus on the four. We aren't told what their names are, but from their actions, we know that they believed. I think that this was such an important story that the Bible mentions it three times in three different Gospels. The first one would come from Matthew 9, 1 to 8, not the Matthew scripture. Mark 2, 1 to 12, and Luke 5, 17 to 26. Anybody know the story I'm talking about? That's the one. So we all know the story. We might not know the addresses, but we know the reference. There was a paralyzed guy, and Jesus was speaking in his hometown. The house was kind of packed. Nobody could get in. I suppose you could get out if you wanted to, but let's talk about getting in. And four friends decided, We want our friend to be healed. They knew who could do it and how he could do it. They just needed to get him there. So what did they do? They put him on his mat, each took a corner, they picked him up, and off they went. Couldn't get inside, because like I said, jam-packed with people, everybody wanted to know who this Jesus was. And if they wanted to know him, they wanted something from him. Jesus was good with that. He just went ahead and did what he was called to do. But dear friends, these four friends didn't stop there. They knew what they needed to happen. So what did they do? They went up onto the roof, dug through the clay roof, and they lowered him down in front of Jesus. Now, if you know anything about the architecture of the houses way back then, it was pretty much sticks, some stones, and clay. Got really hard, but if you worked at it, you could pretty much chip away through it. But Jesus and the people underneath had to know something was happening up there. I mean, come on, you know, you're chipping away and stuff is going to be falling through. It didn't bother Jesus. He kept doing what he was doing until the paralyzed dude was in front of him. Now, I believe that the paralyzed dude shared in this faith too. I mean, he had to, didn't he? Was it all on his friends? I don't think so. Without the faith that he had, I don't think he could have obtained forgiveness. Because it's just what Jesus does, right? He didn't say to the guy, we know the story goes on, he didn't say to him, pick up your stuff, walk, go away, you're healed. He said, your sins are forgiven. And there were Pharisees there, they're like, who's this dude forgiving people? What does he know? They didn't even have to say it. Jesus heard their thoughts and he answered them. But that's a different type of sermon and preach. We're focusing on the four friends. Aren't these the type of people you want to have as friends? People who can tell us the truth and be honest with us no matter what. They know that because you have such a great friendship, you can say pretty much whatever and your friendship will still stand. Some of the people that we are friends with, are they really friends? Are you really a friend to them? Even I know, I'm not always that type of friend. But like we saw, Letitia wanted a little bit of fun. She wanted to hang out with the cool kids and be cool because she wasn't getting that with her group of friends who were good for her. So before we carry on with our amazing youth, I'll leave you with the same questions. Do you have the types of friends that these four friends were? The type of friends that will take you to where you need to be when you need it, regardless of whether you want it or not. More importantly, though, are you this type of faithful friend?
Just as she raised her hand, she realized what she was about to do. She didn't want to hurt this boy. This wasn't like her. This wasn't kind or loving or pleasing to her God. She realized then that she had made a huge mistake, turned and ran back to her good friends. She couldn't believe what she had almost done. She apologized to her friends and asked them to forgive her. They responded with love and said, of course we forgive you, because God forgives us. She started telling them of all the things that she had done with the cool kids and what they were trying to make her do, and then asked if they could all help her pray for them so that they would come to know the love of God too. So they prayed. Instantly, they were reminded that in order for those cool kids to know Jesus, they had to experience him through them, that they were his vessels to pour his love onto others. So they picked an olive branch, walked over to the cool kids, and handed it to them as a peace offering. The cool kids were confused and didn't know what was happening. Tish and her friends explained to them the love and grace of God. Tish told them that she knew they weren't bad people and she wanted to be friends, but told them that friends are kind and loving towards one another. They don't go around hurting each other. She told them that through God's love, they are able to walk in love too and have true joy at any time without having to hurt each other. The cool kids were very intrigued and asked, how? Tish told them about Jesus and how he came into her life, bringing her endless peace and joy, how he brings her comfort when she is afraid, or heals her when she is hurt, and how he forgives and loves her even when she does wrong. The cool kids were amazed and thought, wow, that's pretty cool, and asked how they could have Jesus in their lives too. So she told them that all they have to do is confess with their mouths that Jesus is Lord and believe in their hearts that God raised him from the dead, and they will be saved. Again, they were amazed and thought, wow, that's pretty easy, and all agreed that they wanted Jesus in their lives too. So they all prayed together, accepting Jesus in their hearts and lives, weeping tears of joy and hugging one another. And now they were all cool kids and they went around their school. And they all came to know that Jesus is pretty cool too.
You guys ready to get your praise on? Come on. Up, up.
Your love in me has set me on fire.
Put it out to you. Are you guys going through anything? The littlest thing. I encourage you, come up to the front. Raise your hallelujah with us. It says in the Bible, if you're going through any struggles, praise Him. Praise Him. So come up, come out of your seats. Come and praise Him with us. Love.
just going to have a prayer.
He honore he gloria, he hallelujah ki te atua, he whakaaro pai, he whakaaro pai, he whakaaro pai ki ngā tangata katoa. No reira, kia tau, kia tātou katoa, te ata whai o tō tātou ariki a Ukraiti, me te aroha o te atua, me te whiwhinga taitanga, ki te wairua tapu, āke, 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 āmene.
So we're just going to let the music play softly. Keep the attitude of worship. Let the Spirit move. Thank you, Jesus. Let the Spirit move. Focusing on Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Have a few more moments. Don the rush. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. I'd like to do a prayer call tonight and open up the altar. Two things. If you feel like you haven't been a good friend throughout life to other people, I'd like to open up the altar tonight so you come forward and get some prayer. And the second thing is, if you would like to get reconnected to Jesus, reconnect yourself. Give some time, and or if you just generally want some prayer, the youth will gladly come and with myself and Sherry come and pray for you and pray with you. Just keep the attitude of worship for a moment. Now there's a lot of people up here. If you want to respond to the altar call, just slowly make a step forward. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Right, youth, would you? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Lord, we give you glory. Give you glory, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father.